Back then, things were a lot simpler. But then technology always changes that. Simple strobe lights and, you know, maybe a small stack of speakers and turntables, of course. And now it's rock star stages and crazy lasers and just unbelievable explosions. It was more than just a phrase, underground. It was really underground.
People are going to look for something that they feel is not driven by the establishment, you know, and there's something cool about that.
It's just, it's unbelievable. It really is.
Growing up was a little bit hard. I was raised Pentecostal, which is very strict religion based, and I couldn't really do much on my own. Surviving cancer means a second chance. Beating it was great. The process was the worst I could ever imagine, but now I just feel so alive. I just wanna, you know, live it up as much as I want. You know, and I was like, you know what? I just felt like I haven't really explored myself and who I really am. I've always followed orders. I've always done this for that. But I've never really found my own bliss, and that's what I'm trying to find right now.
Good. My name's Frank Caceres, and back then I was Frank C. That's what they called me. Frank C. Dot, whatever. And I was DJing from 1982 through 1997. But I was involved with the underground scene from the late 80s, around 88. I had already been looking for groups of other people, at least in my neighborhood, that enjoyed this particular type of music like I did, and it was rare. There was maybe a handful of us. So we started on our journey to find out where are people gathering to find this music, and that was in the late 80s, mid to late 80s. So we started to run into people and see familiar faces, and from the record stores and the shops and Hollywood and all those places. So we started going to basically the beginnings of the undergrounds, where like I said, these people were very open to anyone and everybody, but it wasn't just like you can just go to the corner music store or go on the internet and find out what's going on this weekend. You really had to go out there and really want to find it. This is the night that I told you, I think, where I was saying to myself, well, up there, like, things are changing big time here. This is a party called Millennium. It was in 94. Wow. Long time ago, huh?
I definitely like the underground scene because the people that are there are a lot more open and accepting to whatever the DJ has to express. Those underground parties, I do feel strongly about because it's self-expression, not only for the artists, the people that are performing, but it's people that show up there and take the time out of their day, out of their week to even plan and sometimes dress themselves in certain clothes to go there and meet other people alike. From what I've experienced, I know that Parrish has been doing a lot for a really long time, whether it be underground or putting himself forward as a performing artist on stages that aren't underground. To my understanding, it's building something from the ground up for a specific crowd that likes a certain type of music.
You're gonna see people as outrageous as you think you've ever seen anyone, there's always the person that shows up and they take it to the next level.
Studio 69 parties have been going about 3.5 years. And we've been going every month nonstop. We have maybe about 12 to 15 themes that I rotate every year, you know, depending on what, you know, we feel fits the best.
Well, it's cubicle for about 60 hours a week, and I was hating life. You know, I had my first degree by the time I was, like, before I was old enough to drink, and I jumped right into my master's, and then I think about 23, 24, I was working at this firm, and, you know, 4 years later, you know, I was so overwhelmed with, you know, not having enough fun in my life. So I basically just walked out of it and had this, like, early midlife crisis, I guess, and decided that, okay, you know, I can always return to this, but what would I want to do, you know, if I really wanted to embrace my life and explore it, and I'm not going to find that in a cubicle. And, you know, yeah, I love design.
'69 has always been kind of something I just do for fun. I decided one day to throw an event, you know, where I would invite everyone for free to come and kind of, you know, dress up. And, you know, half the party was at my house before the party, like, getting ready, and I was helping them get ready. And it was about just, you know, helping others kind of enjoy this thing that I was doing. And, you know, 300-400 people showed up, and I was like, wow. And then the venue was like, can you do this again, you know? And so I think the evolution of things was always kind of a creative process, and it went from myself and then into a space, and then always kind of involved other people coming and getting inspired by that. And then their inspiration obviously has driven me to today, which is 3 or 4 years later, and I haven't stopped throwing parties ever since. You know, I didn't come into it like a lot of party promoters learn how to come into throwing parties, like maybe they'll, you know, more of a numbers game. I was more of like, okay, what's the creative look and feel of this party that I want to, you know, touch into? The performers, the lighting, anything that you would find at the party itself, you know, I do all that.
A lot of these events actually attract some mainstream type of people. Some of our guests at some of these underground events that we do are actually costume designers for big productions or ongoing shows. So they kind of come out to have fun and exercise their demons too, if you will, and put their creativity out there that they're not allowed to do at the studio. The event that we're going to DJ or where we're going to be present, you know, making an appearance. So whether it be one of Parrish's parties or, you know, another themed party, they usually have anywhere from a month to 2 weeks ahead of time to kind of plan out what it is we're going to be doing. I pick his brain, kind of trying to understand what kind of persona he wants to play, what kind of music he's going to play.
Custom props, obviously, that I talked about earlier, you know, being used on stage, you know, shooting confetti and sparks and smoke. I have stilt walkers that dress up, that walk around, and I tell them just to do whatever they want. You know, I don't really, you know, believe in set times even. I'm like, you know, when you feel like, you know, going out there and inspiring people, just go out and do your thing.
My name is Alexandria, and I'm a go-go dancer and a grindcore girl for Parrish. Basically, Parrish took some type of power tool, which is called like a metal grinder, and he hooked it up to a harness, which we use rods, and we tap it to the beat, making sparks fly out. And usually people don't think it feels very good when they get hit by them, but I actually kind of like it. I put them in my mouth and everything. It's pretty amazing.
What keeps me coming back to these themes is how I never feel alone. It's really depressing that this crowd that we're all in love with, people who are part of it, we love it. And it's sad that when people say it's dangerous, or people do drugs, or people just die.
Back then, the big thing was, I guess that was publicized, was acid and ecstasy and so forth. And I think, not that those drugs were anything new to the world, but I think they were looked at more as more hazardous or more dangerous than, you know, a tall can of whatever. People abuse it, of course, and you're going to get a lot of people in a kind of like a free-flowing type event or that atmosphere, and there are going to be those people who are just, they overdo it.
When people take drugs during my performances, it doesn't really interfere with my performance or my outlook on how the night is going to play out. I remember the first time somebody told me that they were going to take drugs for my performance, and I had felt special almost because they wanted to experience something while I was doing what I loved. And also, that's what people do when they go to these big raves.
Being a nurse and seeing what I've seen, it's definitely reflected on the decisions that I want to make at the raves, for sure.
You know, I just think it's going to get knocked by those who don't understand it and have never been to one. You know, they're just going to look at it as a bunch of out of control kids partying and experimenting with, you know, with drugs and everything else, and just a recluse.
I'll definitely think twice about it, but it's something that I've been wanting to do for a long time, and I want to do the full experience. I'm here to try out everything and everything I can. Like I said, I'm trying to live life to the fullest as much as possible. So I'm here, I'm going to try it out. I'm a bit nervous, and I'm hoping it's going to be fun. It looks fun already. So if it works out, I'm going to continue this for sure. If it doesn't, I'll find something else. You know, like I said, I'm in search for my bliss.
I go about mapping out the space and like figuring out, you know, where I'm going to put things. I think about that journey from the doorway all the way to the bar and to the stage. My hope as a event planner and a host is that when you walk in, there's too much for you to take in. And I really believe in this chaos theory of like being overloaded and then just wanting to kind of, you know, just be absorbed.
I've never been in an environment where you're just so fully accepted for everything that you are.
Those who don't understand it and have never been to one, or maybe aren't as open-minded, accepting of the culture, accepting of the attire, whatever it is that turns them off, but it's much more than that.
If we do these parties every month and we're doing this for years, you know, down the road, I will definitely be an outlet for a lot of people to kind of start out. A lot of people feel it's the only outlet for like true creativity.
they were looking for that experience, that journey, that travel, that hidden, you know, that little hidden city, something just for them but open for everyone if you are willing to take the time to be part of it.
Feeling the music and everything's just like, just gonna be in there and enjoying it, you know, and just enjoy it.